is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Hey, welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host, and I could not be more excited about the interview that we're going to do today because I have a great friend on the other line. And this is before I'm going to give him a little bit of buildup before we before I bring his voice into this wonderful interview. But Paul is a friend of mine. He's been a friend for a long time. He's just an awesome guy, and we share a lot of things in common. But one of the things we share in common is his love for music. Because Paul and I both have a common passion for music. So, hey, we're going to do a first on the Thriving Dentist Show. You're going to hear some live music. Well, hey, let me tell you what the topic is, and then I'll introduce our guest. So, hey, the topic today is technology in dentistry. And in particular, we're going to talk about computers. And we're going to talk about all kinds of cool things that you should be doing today if you're interested in high-tech in dentistry, including we're going to talk about digital impressions today. Hey, how cool is that? And my guest is Dr. Paul Feuerstein. And Paul, for many of our listeners, he will need no introduction at all. Paul's a practicing dentist. He practices every day just like you do outside of Boston, Massachusetts. In addition, Paul is the technology editor at Dental Economics, one of our fine journals here in the United States. But let me give you a couple other pieces of information about Paul's background that you may not know. Every year at the Yankee Dental Congress, which is held in January in Boston, Paul hosts an area of the trade show called the High Technology Playground, which is just an amazing place to get your hands on whatever's happening with technology that particular year. One more bit of background, and then I'll let Paul come on in here. But in 2010, Paul was presented with the Clinician of the Year for the Yankee Dental Conference, and that's a very prestigious award. Hey, Paul, welcome to the show.
Hey, Gary. I was in the middle of practicing for my guitar lesson, and you called me and interrupted me.
Well, listen, thank you for that live bit. First time we've got live music. Hey, Paul,
I could do a whole hour, you know.
We may just do that. I gave you a bit of an introduction, but would you kindly enhance that a little bit and tell our listeners a little bit more about your background?
Well, I wanted to become a dentist from day one. But when I went to college at Stony Brook University in New York, they did not have a pre-dent or a pre-med. So I ended up being a biochemistry major, which turned out to be essentially biochemical engineering, physics, math, calculus, all the great stuff that nobody ever wanted to take. And my minor was music. So I came out of there with kind of a very eclectic situation. And then when I went to dental school, especially my freshman year, as everybody remembers, the most horrifying course that everyone had to take was biochemistry. And I would sit in the back of the room and go to sleep. So, of course, I never had histology or the biology classes. And because of my fascination in undergrad also, part of it was computer programming. So I was programming IBM computers that were probably as big as a house at the time with these things called punch cards, which is way beyond most people's recollection. And when I got to the dental school, it was in New Jersey. They happened to have a gigantic grant from Princeton, New Jersey, which is where the SATs come from and some other things. And they said, hey, we have this like $50,000 grant, Paul, and nobody knows how to turn the computer on. So in my spare time, I played around in the dean's office and did some little IT work with the school. It was very, let me say, really elementary. We're in the 70s on this thing. But when I got out of dental school, I was watching this whole evolution of computers at that time. And thought, gee, why couldn't a dental office have a computer? So off I went in about 1977 and found what was called an office computer, which was about the size of a small dishwasher. I wouldn't even get into the specs of it. It's laughable. And I found a company out in Utah, Provo, Utah, and they installed this thing in my office that no one knew what to do with. And we had terminals, and we had a couple of keyboards, and we were able to do things like basic appointment scheduling, printing out insurance forms, printing out bills right in the office. It was astonishing. This is 1978.
Well, let's put that in perspective for our listeners, Paul. So, and the sobering reality, Paul, is that that year was before some of our listeners were born.
I know that too well.
Yes. So that, I'm not trying to say you're an old guy, all right? Because yeah. I are one too. But that's before some of our listeners were born. But let's put it in a computer context. That's before the PC. Absolutely. Well before the PC.
It's not only is it before the PC, but as this was evolving, my first other computer other than this gigantic monstrosity was made by Radio Shack. And some of our elders might remember this little Radio Shack home computer that didn't have a disk drive. It had a little cassette tape that ran it.
Right, right.
So, and I actually wrote a dental program on that, which was by today's standards was ridiculous. But, you know, I saw this coming. But what evolved, though, was obviously as PCs evolved and the companies evolved, I was getting phone calls from some dental software companies saying, hey, Paul, you speak two languages. Can you help us out? I said, what do you mean? So, well, you speak dentist and computer, and can you help us do that? So I'm not going to say that I helped develop some of the systems, but I certainly had help with the early interface. It was actually myself, Barry Freiberg, perhaps, and Claudio Lovato, I think, were real early on in this whole system of seeing this fascination with PCs, which initially started out as our front office. It was pretty much the office management system, but as technology evolved, little computer chips started showing up in our dental equipment.
Wow.
Everything, and today, of course, you can't move your dental chair without knowing there's a little computer running the dental chair. So the fascination continued and evolved working with the dental software companies, the dental hardware companies, and then the actual manufacturers came back and forth to me. There's a lot of interplay that went on, and it just became part of my practice. So my patients always knew there'd be some cool thing in the office. They didn't quite what it was. certainly, you know, things like intraoral cameras were very early on, and I know some of my dear colleagues like Marty Jablow and John Flukey also came in early on this thing, and we all had a different sort of a fascination with the geeky side of this whole thing.
Paul, we share at least two interests, and actually I know that we share three interests to be sure. We share an interest in music. We share an interest in all things technology, in particular computers. Paul, a little bit of my personal background. The first time I got involved in computers, it was not in, I was still in school, but it was in 1974, and I had some wonderful mentors that taught me how to write some code in 1974. Uh-huh. And I've been passionate about technology and computers ever since. And the third thing that we have to share with our listeners, you know, you and I have had the privilege of being together this year. I think at last count, I think we've been together at least three times at different meetings.
I know what you're going to say. You're going to say we share hair.
I wish we shared hair.
I saw a photo of you from many, many years ago, and your hair was longer than mine.
Well, there was a day when I had hair, so unfortunately we don't share that. But we do share an interest in great food. And you're my food editor and my food photographer on Facebook. So I appreciate the common interest in food as well.
Just one little thing about the music. It was almost like my downfall because in my junior year of dental school, just as we're getting into clinic, I received a recording contract from Decca Records and told my parents that I was leaving dental school and going on tour with a band for a year and then I'd come back to dental school.
Let me guess how that went over.
That didn't go over very well at all. So here I am. But I could have been hanging out with Jimi Hendrix in Paris or something, you know, and probably not been alive to tell the story, to be honest with you.
Well, the dental profession would have been at a loss if that would have happened, Paul.
Thank
so
you, Gary.
We're very thrilled that you chose the profession of dentistry to exercise your talent.
But you never give up your music. Believe me, you're always a musician. Once you're a musician, you're always a musician.
That's right. So, hey, let's start by talking about computers a little bit. And, you know, our listening audience, Paul, we're privileged to have listeners in 105 countries.
Wow.
And we have listeners all over the country. And there'll be people that are listening to this at various stages in their career. If you had to give them a little bit of a computer primer, you know, circa 2013, give us a little Reader's Digest condensed view of your thoughts about computer and application, computers and their application in dental practices today.
Well, this is going to be a tough question because we're in the middle of a big change in using computers in the practices. Because up until recently, you had to buy this gigantic network and a zillion computers and some fabulous big server. and more things are disappearing from the inside of our office to this thing called the cloud. Mm. And the cloud is nothing more than a computer someplace else where all your things are stored. And there's a lot of nervous people saying, well, you know, someone else is handling my patient data, and is it secure, and blah, blah, blah. But I think that as we sit here right now, if I was opening an office right now, I don't know if I'd actually have a computer network server system in my office. I might work everything off of even something as simple as an iPad with a web browser. So the transition right now is changing things. So dentists who have been in practice like myself for a number of years have the infrastructure set up. We have the terminals in the office. We have computers in the office. But more and more of this is being outsourced and exported. So I go into Tufts University periodically, and I watch my students that are sitting there, and as you know, teaching at a dental school, they wouldn't know what a pen or a pencil was if you gave it to them.
Right.
They're sitting there, everything's on their on their iPads or their phones or whatever things they're using. So I actually, for a crystal ball, I honestly don't know what the crystal ball is right now. That's kind of an interesting question.
Now, so let's talk about this cloud-based scenario now. If you were a young doctor, maybe a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, and let's say you were either going to start or purchase a practice, and you were going to make some decisions about that, do you feel like, you know, sitting here in late October 2013, that the cloud-based systems are advanced enough to have them be a viable option when it comes to running your software?
I don't want to get in trouble here with the manufacturers because I love them all.
Yes.
I think we're still early on this system. I think that there are a number of systems that are sitting out there that work. Some have just been introduced. Part of the problem still is the infrastructure of the internet itself. I mean, you have to have – I'm in New England. And we have a thing plugged in the wall, and if we have some issue with a snowstorm or a snowplow hitting a certain pole, my internet could be down.
Yes.
And so that's one – it's a minor thing, but it's something to be concerned with, I think. There's still a lot of development going on with the instantaneous information that you're going to get through this cloud system, through this internet-based system. So if I have a starting practice, to be honest with you, I think we could do it. You're not going to have thousands of patients in the database. You're not going to have all sorts of things going on, multiple providers, multiple hygiene things. So I think for the basic office at this point, I think it's going to work out fine. If I was to convert my practice now, we have a two-doctor practice with a number of hygienists. We're open literally 5 days and four nights with a lot of providers going on. I'm not so sure at this second I'd dive into the cloud just yet.
But it's certainly coming.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And to think about right now, like if we have to have an update, if we sweat it. We go, oh, no, a new update's coming in. We have to throw a disk in or do something, and it has to do with my server. So what if the thing goes wrong on my server and something happens and my server goes down? If it's cloud-based, this is all automatic. Everything just happens by itself. Plus, the bigger point is there's no backups. Mm. I don't have to back up my data. They have it all.
Right.
And it's usually redundant. It's not just in somebody's backyard. It's in... You know, there's things called redundant servers, and that's what the whole basis of this cloud is, that whatever information you have, let's say if it's in Scottsdale, it could also be in Boston, it could also be in Toronto, Canada, for all we know.
Right.
So that's the nice part of that whole system. That's really seamless and very simple. There's nothing you have to do. You just turn on your browser, turn on your system, you're up and running, everything's ready to go. You can access it from any place. If I'm visiting it down in Arizona, out in California, push a button and I'm on my system.
Right.
I mean, you can use remote access, like go to my PC or log me in, of course.
Sure.
It's live, it's there.
Now, the other advantage of the cloud-based system is that your hardware becomes a bit agnostic, doesn't it? You can use whatever hardware you want.
Pretty much. And you don't have to worry if you're Mac-based or if you're PC-based or Unix or Linux or any kind of other thing. As long as you have that web browser sitting there, that's all it needs.
Well,
I have to qualify that, though. Certain pieces of hardware that we use, for example, digital sensors, may have some issues with certain systems. I have to be honest.
Okay, perfect.
So you have to watch that a little bit. But again, everybody's for once, everybody's talking to everybody. It's a unique thing in dentistry.
Hey, I'll be with you. I'll stay safe here and not mention any brand names or mention any particular products. But one of the things that I'm starting to see develop is with the cloud-based systems is the way the interface with our peripherals are working. If, for example, digital radiography and digital photography. Early in the game with cloud-based systems, some of those peripherals weren't working as well as they should. But today, they're getting some of the kinks worked out. Would you agree with that, Paul?
Yeah, I would. I'll mention a product, and I'm not sure. Endorsing this product. The company called Curve Dental has this pretty well under control, I have to say. They're out of Utah,
right?
And they do a nice job. You can it seems to be live when you take the X-ray. It shows up on your screen. It seems to be live, and it's actually running through their entire network. And they're not the only ones, but they happen to be. Right now, they made a lot of noise in dentistry. I have to say that right now.
Right, you know, Paul, you were certainly a pioneer in 1978. I don't know where to do the research on this, but you might have been one of the very first dentists to have a computer in their practice.
As far as I know, there were a handful of us, because there were only a couple of companies that actually made this hardware and software. So from Boston, I had to go running out to Provo, Utah, to find this one particular company. There were two or three. One was based in Utah. One was based in California, I think was the other one, this mine was called Praxis, Praxis.
I do remember.
The other was called Alpha Micro, I believe. And honestly, I can't remember the other ones off the top of my head. So they were out there, but I would say if there were a dozen of us at that time, I'd be surprised.
Well, you were quite sage in looking in the crystal ball and kind of predicting the coming trend in computers in 1978. So I'm going to ask you to get your crystal ball out. Can you dust it off, Paul?
Okay, here we go.
So if you had to dust this off, I'm going to come back to cloud-based systems. Do you see a future somewhere down the road where most of the systems are cloud-based?
Oh, absolutely. Because the software is being written that way. I mean, if you go to the Microsofts and think places like that, they're writing a lot of the new software that doesn't require a computer. It requires you to have a subscription to whatever they have. So Microsoft Word, PowerPoint, Excel, all these things are currently online in the cloud system. And so there's no reason that if a company like that can't do it, why can't some dental company do the same thing? So that's absolutely up on the horizons. Sure.
Paul, let me shift gears. We're going to come back to computers and we'll talk other computer related topics. But to switch gears for just a minute, we didn't talk about this ahead of time in the show prep. So I'll put you on the spot. Hey, if we need to edit it, we can do it because I own the show. But I'm going to put you on the spot. Can you name three pieces of technology that you would not want to practice without today in your practice? Give me three that you'd be ready to hang up your handpiece if you couldn't have this technology in your practice.
Let's see. Three pieces. Number one is the intraoral camera, period. Hands down, that's the most important thing I use in my practice. I use it on every single patient every single day.
Okay, I pause here for just a minute, Paul. I want our listeners to hear what you just said. You said you use this every time on every patient every day. Paul, you're reading out of my playbook. This is awesome.
Well, here's why. If a patient comes into they sit in my chair. Instead of saying, open your mouth, say, here's what we're doing today. I take a picture of the tooth. Simple thing. The most amazing thing to a patient is if you say, here's this old silver tooth, and we'll take a picture of it, and then we finish the case, and we say, here it is now. They go, wow, it's white. It looks like a tooth. I mean, I'm not doing it with the most. The reason we're doing this is, A, for diagnosis, because the cameras we're using are pretty good now, and B, it's actually for a liability issue. That if something happens, and I document the number of things that have gone wrong, you go back to that original photo and say, gee, you know what? We never noticed this fracture was over here. It's not like I caused it. It had been there pre-existing. Probably should have seen it in the first place. But things like that, where it's critical. But mostly for the patient, A, entertainment, and B, education. Certainly, every single emergency patient that comes in instantly, first thing my assistant does is before I even get in the room is has usually a radiograph, but always, not forget the radiograph, always a photo, an intraoral photo. Wow. Absolutely. And what we do is we'll let it sit on the screen sometimes. If it's something very obvious, they come in, I chip this thing, which everybody has that. You take the picture, you leave it on the screen, I don't even come in the room. I let them stare at it for a while.
There you go.
And now here's a name out of the past, Bob Barkley.
Bob Barkley. Do you know Paul, that I have his widow, Willa, was kind enough to provide me some of the resource material that was in Bob's library. You know, Bob passed away in 1977.
Yep.
Sadly, we lost him way too early.
It was horrible.
But he died in a plane crash in 1977.
Right.
And I have many of his original resource material in my library. In fact, I have a patient brochure, Paul, that Bob wrote in 1962. Okay, 1962. This was in downstate Illinois. Trying to think of the little town that he practiced in downstate Illinois.
Oh boy, but I don't remember.
Little tiny town. He wrote a patient brochure in 1962 that Paul, for about, I could take about 99% of the copy of that brochure and reprint it today in 2013 as just as current today as it was when he wrote it.
Well, his main mantra, for lack of a better word, was show the patient what they have and they'll tell you what they need. Simple as that.
Ah.
And he never saw an intraoral camera.
No.
I mean, he had saw photography. This would have been his whole, I mean, if he saw an intraoral camera photo, he would just have stood on his head for this. This was just the greatest thing going.
I agree. Okay, we've got number one. And the question was,
I
asked Paul.
That's number one and two.
Well, perfect. If there was one thing, you know, three things that he wouldn't want to practice without in terms of technology, what are they? And he said, number one, intraoral cameras. So give me two more, Paul.
Okay, I'll say them fast and then I'll detail them. I think digital radiography with sensors, I think, is number two right now. And this, again, I'm thinking of things that we use every single day and couldn't practice without. Just in a nutshell, I don't want to get into the megapixels and all this sort of fancy stuff. Just a simple workflow. It gets up on the screen. You can see it. The patient can see it. There's a lot of diagnostic tools that go along with this. You don't just have a raw image. You can play with it with some little tools and toolbars, enhance things and use magnification, use filters, colorization, whatever it is. And you can get a much, much better diagnosis with an intraoral, with a digital radiography. Pretty much as simple as that. And obviously, the exporting of the files to specialists and to whoever else, it just makes life so simple.
Right.
So I think those are the two of the three things that I have my hands on all the time. But I could spend 2.5 hours on digital radiography with you. But my number three thing is, you said something funny, and the answer was handpiece. I have an electric handpiece, and it took me a long time to get this electric handpiece. I won't mention the Swiss company's name right now.
Sounds like can we do charades? It sounds like.
But people just assumed that I just assumed that this electric handpiece was just some more robust tool that I could use to prep teeth with and cut off crowns with. But the beautiful thing about the electric handpiece is you have high speed and slow speed. And you can run this thing at all sorts of combinations of torque control, speed, and you're not just stepping on the foot pedal and running at 200,000, 300,000 RPMs with no torque. We're running at 40,000 with one-to-one torque, with very high torque. We're running, doing carriage removal with the slow speed and certain burrs at like 2,000 RPMs with very, very little torque on those, and you can get absolutely fabulous caries removal and finish your crown margins. So I'm constantly playing with the buttons on this thing, and we have sort of everybody evolves their own comfort level, whereas a lot of dentists just buy it and they just push it on high speed, 1 to 5, 200,000, boom, let's just go with it, not realizing what a great piece of equipment this is and how versatile it is. I mean, something as simple as using sandpaper discs. You're not going to run those at 200,000. You can run it at one.
Really, you have infinite customization of different qualities of the handpiece depending on what you're doing. You can move it from high torque to high speed and everywhere in between to really tailor it to whatever you're doing, whatever procedure you're doing with that particular patient.
Absolutely.
Ah.
Absolutely. I guess I'll have to mention some names. There's Genia, Cavo, Serona, some other companies that have all now shortened and smallened. Is that a word? Shortened and made smaller and lightweight the handpieces, which used to be pretty darn heavy. And so the first ones, and that was part of my rejection initially, these things really, I had them for trial. My hand hurt at the end of the day.
Too heavy. Mm-hmm.
And now they've really changed the whole system with the lighter motors and cords and the hoses are much, much more ergonomically done, and it's really not an issue. And then people with smaller hands had problems, and without being sexist, a lot of women stayed away from these things because they were just gigantic and very physically heavy. So I think that's opened up that world also to the smaller-handed dentist, lighter, you know, hand dentist. And I just think that's a great tool. So those, I guess those are my top three. If after we hang up, I'll probably think of three other ones.
Well, I put you on the spot there, and as expected, you performed, Paul. Well, hey, you know, at your high-technology playground there at Hinman. And by the way, for any of our listeners, if you have not made the trip to Boston in January to visit visit the Yankee Dental Congress.
Hinman's great too. I love it.
Hinman's a good meeting too, but that one is in the spring in Atlanta. I'm talking about the Yankee Dental Congress. That was my mistake. If you haven't made the trip in January to visit the Yankee Dental Congress in Boston, I want to strongly encourage you to do that. First of all, it's in a fantastic part of the country. If you've never been to New England, and for those of our international listeners, if I can give you an excuse to get to Boston, this is it. But come visit the meeting. It's a fantastic meeting. Paul, would you agree?
I would agree, except I have a pet peeve with two meetings. One is mine, which is Yankee, and the other one is Chicago Midwinter. And the name Midwinter actually describes the problem. it's a crapshoot sometimes coming to the dental meeting, Yankee or Chicago, and you may have to have boots that are about, you know, 3 feet high to trudge through the snow and the slush. Having said that, we've been very, very, very lucky at Yankee. That's all I can say. It makes you want to take two trips to New England, one in the middle of the winter to see the winter of our area with this lot of skiing, et cetera, and then come back either in the summer or right now at fall. We just finished our peak foliage season in the Massachusetts, Vermont, Maine, New Hampshire area. So there's a lot of reasons to come out to visit us. Plus, we have great lobsters.
You know, Paul, I this is a bit of my history that you don't know, so I'll share something with you. But a couple years ago, I was invited to speak at a course in the extreme northern part of New Hampshire. It was a small town, and it was sponsored by a specialist. It was sponsored by an oral surgeon, and he invited all his referral sources to come, and they came from about 4 hours away. And we timed this so I could be there in about the middle of October, and we happened to be very lucky. Oh. We timed it with the peak week, and he took me on the Kankamangus Highway.
That's right. Uh-huh. North Conway, New Hampshire.
Yeah. How was that for – did I get a good a view of the foliage on the Kankamangus Highway?
That's the top of the line.
It was wonderful. Well, hey, tell our listeners a little bit about the high technology playground. You shared a statistic with me about how many pieces of technology you have in there. Share with our listeners what this high technology playground that is that you host there at the Yankee Dental Congress.
Well, first of all, I'm kind of nuts because I say to the Yankee, you know, Yankee's part of the reason I'm doing what I'm doing. They were very helpful in my coming into fruition as whatever I do right now.
Well, whatever, and you are.
that's my home base. So we've set up this very, very large booth in the middle of the floor. This year, actually, in 2014, we're making a minuscule change because we're rolling it up for 2015. But in any case, I give about 10 lectures over 3 days, and in the room, we cover hands-on probably 65 to 70 products that I sort of hand-pick off the floor, bring them into the room. And the beautiful thing about this setup, and I've also done similar setups in other meetings, just not as elaborate, there's no salespeople allowed. Uh-huh. So the nice thing is it's 100% CE. So if you're sitting there and you want to take a look at a piece of equipment, you're sitting there talking not to a salesperson but to a representative who's more of a training person or some corporate person, and they explain the process, and no one's sitting there with a pen and a pad and saying, hey, doc, sign here right now. Mm-hmm. You have that option to walk out the door, which is right next to you, and go onto the floor and buy whatever you want to buy. But it's a very, very nice non-sales, non-threatening environment. And we have the Ghostbusters sign out in front of it, with that big round circle with the slash that says no sales zone.
So this is a pretty pure environment where you can get a chance to experience this technology and talk to clinicians that have some experience using it.
Exactly. And again, just because Yankee allows me this gigantic space, but I've done very similar workshops at most of the other meetings that around the country. I'm preparing one right now for, in fact, Toronto right now. And next year we're going to go to Denver and to Texas and who knows where. And we just finished one at CDA. As a matter of fact, at CDA, we did a giant workshop, and I needed a little help, so who do you think I called? I called Marty Javlow and John Flukey, so the three of us had a lot of fun in our own playground. But we weren't allowed to call it the playground over there, so we called it the carnival.
Oh, there we go. Hey, by the way, for our listeners that don't know Paul's two partners in crime, John Flukey is a practicing dentist in the Kansas City area. Marty Javlow practices in New Jersey. And the three of them, John, Marty, and Paul, make up my high-tech go-to guys in dentistry.
They call me the grandfather because I'm older than both of them put together.
Maybe in chronology, but in spirit, you're a young guy, Paul. But hey, let's switch gears and come back to kind of computers and technology again for just a minute. But the number one question I get these days when I'm lecturing is the question about digital impressions and whether the technology is there and what are the benefits and so on. Can we spend a few minutes and talk about digital impressions?
Yeah, let me talk to you from a couple of perspectives. Let me answer the question first. Digital impressions work, period, end of the story. Digital impressions are actually equal to and or better than traditional impressions, and you can verify this. We have studies from Tufts University, and dental lab after dental lab will tell you they prefer at this point to get a digital impression sent to them. So when people think of digital impressions, they think of the granddaddy of them all, which is CEREC, which has been around for almost 30 years now. Mm-hmm. And the CEREC system is fabulous because not only can you take this digital impression, but you can design your crowns or bridges or implants now or surgical guides, whatever it is, right in your own office. So theoretically, if a patient spent your entire day with you with a CEREC today, a brand new patient could walk in your door. You could take a cone beam CT scan on them, send that to the CEREC machine. The CEREC would design the crown, tell you where to put the implant, make a surgical guide. The patient could walk out that day with an implant, an abutment, a crown, and leave in one day. So it's that crazy at this point.
Wow.
So CEREC sort of set the groundwork, but they're the ones that everybody's trying to knock off the top of the chain right now. And certainly we have E4D, iTero, and 3M, which is the Lava COS. They just changed the name to I always forget it, True Definition.
Right, that's right.
So, and then there's a dozen more, which I don't want to get into all of them, but the bottom line with digital impressions is, first, let me explain a little puzzle piece for my own self, and I have a kind of a sad story for me anyway. About 6 or 7 years ago, I got a phone call in Massachusetts from a group called Brontes, and they said, we're developing a new intraoral impression scanner, and we have this brilliant idea. And they wanted me to be sort of the clinical director and run the clinicals. So we went through FDA approval. So I was able to actually do field testing as this was evolving, hardware, software, and clinical on my own patients. So the fun of this was we had a new system. The patients had to sign some special documentation. It was very, very well controlled by the FDA and some other agencies. And we took traditional impressions and we took digital impressions with this new machine and did comparisons A/B. And this was not done too it was more of a explorer type of thing. It fit, it didn't fit. The margins were good, the margins weren't good. And it took us about 60 restorations to get to a point where in a blind test, because I never knew where the restorations came from, I was not able to tell by about the 50th or 60th restoration whether it was from the traditional impression or the digital.
Wow.
So it was interesting for me to see how this whole process evolves and learn how these things are developed. And, of course, I had to go down to CEREC and E4D and iTero and the other company and see what these things look like and learn how they all work. Not only how they took the impressions, but how they actually physically work, the hardware, the software, thus putting me, in this luxurious position of understanding all these things as they evolve right now. So here's the sad story. So as this company was evolving and it was run by – it's kind of – kind of makes me laugh. It was run by these two young kids who are MBAs and a couple guys from MIT. And I said, you know what? This is my big chance in dentistry to make some money. I said, why can't I come into this company and like own a piece of the company? I mean, wouldn't that be great?
Sure.
And by the time I got all my act together, they said, hey, Paul, guess what happened? 3M came and bought us. For close to $100 million, by the way. And I had no equity in the company at the time. They were very good to me. I'm not saying but that was my big shot, and I kind of skipped it there.
What could have been, huh?
Yeah, yeah. It wouldn't have changed me.
That's right. You'd still be coming to work every day, wouldn't you?
I'd have bought some new guitars.
Oh, okay.
Maybe some of the speakers for my stereo.
There you go. There you go.
So just getting. Let me, if you give me my soapbox for about 5 minutes.
Please.
Here. The digital impression systems as they sit right now are all excellent. And I have like a little drop-down list that I like to do in my lectures, courses, and my writings. And the reason that you are told most of the time to get a digital impression system is that your patients hate impressions. And that's sort of true. You always remember those patients who just couldn't handle an impression in their own mouth and they gagged or whatever it was and they made a comment about it. But, you know, when patients come to the dentist, unfortunately, they hate everything. They hate the x-rays. They hate the taste of the prophy paste. They hate the sound of the drill. They hate the anesthetic. So to say that they hate impressions is just one more thing on
just
the list.
Just a continuum.
So that's all. So, yeah, I mean, when we did the A-B studies in my practice, you know, after we had a little poll and said, well, which one was easier? They go, well, the one with the machine was easier than the one that they did on that stuff. So, of course, that's the thing. But all the systems are doing the same sort of thing, and they're all very, very fast. Right now, a digital impression is at least 2 to 3 times faster than a traditional impression, and what you see on the screen is what you get. And there's an old thing from the computer world called WYSIWYG.
Right.
What you see is what you get. And if you see it on the screen, it's done. When you take an impression with your patients, a standard impression, every dentist who's listening to this has a prayer. They have a little prayer that takes 2 minutes long, and they go, I hope there's no bubbles. I hope there's no pulls. I hope the margins come out. I hope this, that, and the other thing.
And that's a non-denominational prayer too, correct, Paul?
Absolutely.
I mean, that's in every faith.
Every faith has the same prayer. And so you lose that. You see it on the screen, and if there's something you missed with the impression, you just go back and shoot it again, and you're talking seconds. We just did a demo recently with some dentists who had never touched one of these in their lives, and they scanned a lower quadrant in 45 seconds, never having seen the machine before in their lives. Full upper and lower, full quadrant, upper and lower, probably 90 seconds tops, and that's for an uninitiated user. A good user could probably do it in 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, talk about faster. The accuracy is, as I said, the dental labs can prove the accuracy is absolutely dead on. I will say that the margins are absolutely perfect. The contacts are absolutely perfect. The occlusion is a work in progress right now. We've gotten down to a point where you can get perfect centric occlusion. The patient is biting now. When we take a bite for whether it's a triple tray or a wax bite or a impression bite, the patient is biting on some stuff and you don't see what they're doing. With digital impression, you can see the patient in contact, in occlusion, and you're scanning this whole thing from the buckle. So the occlusion for centric is dead on, unless the patient has multiple centrics.
Right.
So usually when you get these crowns back from the laboratory, or if you're making them in the office, your seat time is probably 5 minutes. The thing just seats. There's minuscule playing around with it. And the only thing you usually have to do at this point is work with the excursions and certain excursive movements that the patient's having. So I always find that to be very, very interesting. But the most interesting thing I found was that every single dentist who gets a digital impression system ends up doing better preparations. And the reason that this happens is we, many of us listening, have loops. We get 2x, 2.5, 3, 3.5, 4, whatever they go to. Some of us use microscopes. And anytime you've used these things, you know that your margins look smoother, everything looks nicer because you're working, because you can see better. When you have a digital system, you take this digital impression and you have to analyze it on the screen. And you can have a 21-inch screen. You have the thing sitting there, you go, wow. And you start seeing things that you might not have seen before. So you start almost like preparing your preps for this machine because you want the machine to be able to see it properly. And every single dentist who buys one of these systems and starts using one of these systems says, my preparations look so much better.
Wow. You know, I hadn't thought about that, Paul, but that makes perfect sense.
Very interesting.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. Wow.
So at this point, so the question right now is – dentists are saying, well, you know, what if there's a new one that comes out? What if there's a cheaper one that comes out? In dentistry, we're kind of stuck. We're a small group of people. It's a small, what's called a vertical market. So the companies are not going to be selling thousands and thousands of these machines. They're only going to be selling hundreds or tens of the machines. So they're not going to be mass producing them like other things in the industry.
Sure.
So the pricing is not going to go that much lower. They have to, you know, someone still has to pay for the engineers to do the R&D and for the person with the 800 number to call up when you have a problem. So, I mean, I think 3M just dropped it down to about $12,000, mm-hmm. which was remarkable for the intraoral scanner. So that's a very, very nice entry-level system. Sirona just came out with a lower-end CEREC. I think it's called the Apollo. So they're looking at this whole setup to say, if you want to get in, you can get in on the lower-end side. So it doesn't have to be a big megabucks situation. At this point.
Now, Paul, how would you, you've characterized some benefits. I heard you talk about how it's faster, how it's more accurate, how it makes them a better dentist because of the dynamic of being able to see it on the screen and perform to that standard. How would you ask doctors that are thinking about this to think about the ROI, the return on that investment? If we have business-minded listeners, how would you kind of justify the ROI for digital impressions?
Well, there's two sets of ROIs. Let's first look at the bigger systems, the CEREC, the E4D, mm-hmm. the new Castrium system. There's a new system from Glidewell that allows you to mill in your own office.
Okay.
The ROI there is pretty obvious, that if you're doing X number of restorations and you are making them in your own office, there's no laboratory fee, there's no materials fees, the chair time is a lot less. So the ROI on those systems, which are the more expensive systems, but the ROI is very, very simple to see. I mean, you're saving, if nothing else, even an hour of chair time is worth whatever it's worth.
Sure.
On top of the fact of all these dispensables.
But you could you could quantify that in terms of the displaced cost. Instead of paying a lab fee, we're doing it in-house. We've got some material costs, but they're very minor compared to
Absolutely.
The traditional method. You could actually do the computation on that and figure out how many units a month you'd have to do to be in the more favorable position with digital impressions.
Absolutely, and it behooves everybody, if they're interested in that, to have a salesperson, and that's their job, a salesperson to sit down with a spreadsheet and look at the practice and do some numbers, and it's very, very simple to get the ROI, provided you're doing that in the first place. It's not a magic trick. If you've only been doing 10 crowns a month, it's not going to make you do 30.
Right.
So it has to be, it's a replacement, not a panacea in that mm-hmm. respect. Mm-hmm. But if we just look at the digital impression systems, which runs anywhere from, let's say now, about $12,000 to perhaps as much as $40,000 just for the front end of this impression system, still, the time savings, the accuracy, the seat times, and your own sanity and your own heartburn rate goes lower by having these systems. And again, the knowledge that you have a perfectly good impression immediately, and you still are some physical cost savings in terms of material itself. I mean, a triple tray costs anywhere from, if you're using a triple tray, $10 to $20 to $25 per time.
Mm-hmm.
If you're shipping a case out to the lab, there's an outbound shipping cost. There's model costs that they're not using models these days. So there's some physical hard savings, but I think the main saving is just your basic sanity of practice. The ROI is a little bit, may not be a hard number, but it's a lot. It's a sanity number, is what I'd rather say.
Now, Paul, let me ask you this. So imagine, you know, in our office, Carly, my treatment coordinator, gives a tour. And she gives the patient a very quick tour. It takes about 3 minutes. And it's not really a tour like a behind-the-scenes, open-every-cupboard mm-hmm. kind of tour. It's more a matter of helping the patients understand what we're about and what's available in our practice. Wouldn't it be very cool for Carly to be able to say, and we're really proud to offer our patients digital impressions. If you require any restorations, we do those digitally now. And that's just a really cool a bit of technology we've added to better serve our patients. Now, how do you measure? I mean, this is a rhetorical question. I'm not really looking for an answer here, Paul, but how do you measure the value that the patient receives when they hear that kind of information in terms of thinking that you're state of the art?
Well, that's exactly what it is, that the patients will come to your office because you are state of the art. The people come to my office, they're always looking around. They spin their heads around every time they come in. They go, what's new? What do you got now? But what's kind of funny to me is I teach some of the undergraduates at Tufts. I teach the junior class at least once a year and give them a little overview. And I'm showing them all this 3D modeling and all this stuff, and they're like laughing. They go, I can do that on my phone. You know? You know? So it's almost expected. I mean, they go, you mean you couldn't do this before? So we have a whole shift of age here coming into our practices of, you know, I'll call them kids because I could say this, half my age. Well, actually, bless kids in their 30s who are dentists, are patients coming into the practices, and kind of expect this stuff.
Yeah. But Paul, give me a perspective here, because your patient base is really a very diverse patient base in terms of ages. You certainly have some young patients, some young college students. You have young professionals. And do you happen to know how old your oldest patient is?
Yep. 96.
Okay. We actually have
with
a patient
with teeth.
We actually have a patient 101 years old.
Wow.
And with teeth. Imagine that. And
well,
so
this lady, by the way, went into full ortho at 77.
Oh, how cool is that? So with that, age span among your patients, is it a fair statement that all of your patients are impressed with the technology, regardless of their age?
Yeah, I'd say so. The older ones are fascinated by all this stuff, for lack of a better word, mm-hmm. and the younger ones are glad to see it.
Yeah.
Basically.
I love it. You know, I think Paul is such a great example of someone who has embraced technology throughout his career. And I can imagine that this is one of the things that makes dentistry fun for you today.
It's, you know, my patients are saying to me, you know, boy, you've been practicing for a long time. Well, let's not say how long. And they go, when are you going to retire? And I said, when my enthusiasm disappears.
What a great answer.
I go in. And I know every day is not a great day in the office, as we all know. But for the most part, I go in there and I can look forward to, you know, using some things that just came in the mail yesterday. You know, try out this new composite, try out this new thing, try out this new camera, try out this. And so it's kind of exciting for me to do that sort of thing. And the secondary part is that the cores I used, as we're going way back to what we said earlier, as I am using all this photography, I'm using digital photography, natural photography, et cetera, I document a lot of these things. And I bring them around and show them to dentists in my classes, dentists, dental hygienists, dental assistants. And it's the real deal. I mean, these are real, real patients. I'm using this stuff. There's nothing special. If you went into my office, you'd go, this is the place? It's just a dental office with a lot of wires, way more wires than I'd like to see. I trip over them sometimes. But to me, it's just I like going to work every day. And as I said, once that enthusiasm is gone, I'll be playing on a park bench with my guitar somewhere.
You know, that represents a kind of a good way to bring our discussion to a wrap here. You know, if you're a regular listener of the Thriving Dentist Show, you know that there's one requirement for all of our guests, and that's that they be passionate about what it is that they do. I think you can see why I wanted to have Dr. Paul Feuerstein on our show. Not only is he a great friend, but he's a living, breathing example of someone that truly embraces his profession and enjoys coming to work every day. You know, you call your the area within the Yankee Dental Congress your high technology playground, but I think your dental office is a bit of playground for you, and I'm using that in the most complimentary way.
Without a doubt.
You know, but boy, there's that live music again. How cool is that? Hey, Paul, I'm sure our listeners, many of our listeners, would like to be able to get in touch with you. If they'd like to get in touch with you, how could they reach you?
It is very easy. My email address is quite simple. It's Dr. Paul, DRPAUL, at toothfairy.com. I got that real early in the whole system here. And I'm pretty good, even internationally, I'm pretty good at answering emails almost as fast as I receive them, unless I'm in the middle of a patient or I might be sleeping at some point in there. I try, and I'm a little embarrassed about it, but I try to maintain a website that's called computersindentistry.com.
All spelled out?
All one long word, computersindentistry.com. It's a little, I'm just kind of far behind. I have the ADA meeting coming up in about 2 weeks, and I'll be seeing a lot of new product introductions, and that's when I'm going to sit down after that meeting and revamp it and put all the new stuff in. So by the end of the year, I'll have a lot of new things in there. So it's a little year, some stuff's about a year old, but there's a lot of information sitting in there, a lot of direct links to companies, things like that.
Well, as a listener, we'll put those both of those contact points in our show notes, but let me repeat those for you. If you'd like to reach Paul by email, his email is Dr. Paul. Now, is that DRPAUL?
Yep. DRPAUL.
Dr. Paul at toothfairy.com. And if you'd like to connect with his URL or his website address, it's computersindentistry.com. We'll put those in the show notes. Well, Paul, I want to take a minute and say thank you. You're an awesome friend. We've had a chance to spend quite a bit of time together this year, and I look forward to spending more time together. You know, when you and John and Marty and myself are together, we have a great time. And, you know, I count myself very fortunate to have friends like you in dentistry. You're part of what makes my work such a great time. So, Paul.
Well, and I want to emphasize that word friend, because we also have some, you know, we obviously correspond about family, et cetera, et cetera. And it's just an important thing. I think dentistry has, to me, one of the beautiful things about doing what I've been doing is I've made some real friends, and Gary, you are one of them.
Well, thank you, Paul. We share that, and you and I, when we're not together, we get to connect on Facebook and social media and Twitter. You know, we're very active on social media channels, and I'm very thankful to have those, because when we're not face to face, we can still stay connected. You got to see some pictures of our family visit to go visit our daughters this weekend down at University of Arizona. You saw those on Facebook.
That's right. And, beautiful girls, by the way.
And you too. And I got to share. I didn't quite get to share the food, but I got to see your latest trip up to Maine, and it looked to me like the lobster were fantastic.
They always are.
Well, if you're a listener to the show, thank you for being a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show. I have two requests for you. If you like what you hear, you know, obviously we make this available free. There's no charge to listen to the Thriving Dentist Show. That's a model that I want to continue as we move into the future. But if you like what you hear, if you could support us a couple of different ways, please let your colleagues know. We'd love to have even more listeners. We have listeners in 105 countries now, but would like them even more, and we'd like more listeners in the countries that we're in. So perhaps it's someone from dental school that you've stayed connected with, or a neighbor of yours, or someone at the Dental Society. Tell them about the Thriving Dentist Show. Let them know it's on iTunes, and we'd love to have even more listeners. My second request is more specific. If you like what you hear, if you'll jump on iTunes and write us a review. We have quite a number of reviews on iTunes, but would like even more. So you could support is by doing either of those things. Hey, before we get to our official outtake music, Paul, would you like to take us out with a little bit of live music? Well, hey, on that note, thank you so much. I'll look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show. Thank you.
Dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.